Good day, sir. Let me just say thank you very much for joining this special program. Revelation TV often has the opportunity to interview people that have something quite profound to say and something very well worth listening to. So we want you for the next 55 minutes to enjoy this program. We do have a scientist with us, Professor Andy Macintosh. Let me just welcome him to the program right now. Welcome to the program, Andy.
Thank you very much, Howard. It's very good to be on your program, and I've been on with you before, and I appreciate all the work that you do at Revelation TV.
But Andy's doing this all by Skype, not going to be talking about much else other than how wonderful, really, and how God has created amazing things, including the hearing. And give us an opening, just a summary of what you're going to be talking about.
Well, if we just put up slide one, which is the title slide, the wonder of hearing is probably, when you just look at this baby's ear and you see the sophistication even of the outer ear before we start getting involved in the inner ear, what I'm going to be talking about is just the amazing way by which all the sound waves of voice or music gets into our brains. That's what I'm going to be talking about. I know it sounds to many people, oh, it's obvious. But it's not obvious. It's actually very sophisticated and shows to us Romans 1:20, the invisible things of God are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made.
Fantastic. So you're saying now that even just the design of the ear, as far as the external is concerned, is also quite an amazing piece of the human anatomy. Can you just explain a little bit more in depth about that?
If you put up slide two, you've got another wonderful little picture there, which has a verse on it. The hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord has made even both of them. That's in Proverbs. Now, I want you to see that that really is the case, Howard, and all your viewers. Because if we put up the slides three, which have a tuning fork and a vibration of some signal being received by the eardrum, that just demonstrates the initial point that I want to make, Howard, which is that sound is compression waves. We need to just have everybody on board on this point, that people might be wondering, well, what is sound? Sound is tiny little bumps, if you like, of the molecules of the air bumping against each other and being compressed and then pushed away again. And we call this compression waves. You can only get it really in gases and liquids, this transmission of sound. If you have a vacuum, you wouldn't get this at all. So sound that I'm using now is actually being picked up by a microphone all the way to your studio. That's an amazing fact in itself, but we won't go into that. But we all hear each other's sound because in the air close to us, there is vibration of these molecules of the gas, usually that we're in, which is bouncing against each other and forming these waves. And these waves have an amplitude.
I was just going to mention that word. Where does amplitude come into this?
Well, the amplitude, Howard, is to do with how strongly those waves are being made.
The volume, so in other words.
Yes, it's linked to volume. It's how much, if you can see my hands here, how much we are squeezing the air and how much, by contrast, then the air moves away from each other. So you get this vibration in the air. And if we have a very large amplitude, it's like that. When it's a very small amplitude, it's like that. The other point, Howard, I need to say is that there is a frequency. So it's how much it's doing that, or low frequency, it would be like that.
Slower. Okay? Okay. So now, the faster it is, the higher the frequency.
It got it. Got it exactly. That's that's exactly what I'm trying to say. Now, the amazing thing about the outer ear, if we come to slide five. Slide five has the picture of the outer ear. Now, amazingly, that outer ear goes, as we all know, to an ear canal, which you're tempted to try and poke things down, which you shouldn't do. because it's very delicate at the eardrum, right to the extreme right of the picture is the eardrum. Well, that ear canal is rather like, now slide four, it's rather like a musical instrument, a flute. Now, if I close off all the holes on a flute, then I'll get something rather like the fundamental, as it's mentioned there, the fundamental harmonic. However, if I open holes at different points, I can get different notes playing. So don't worry too much about the detail of this, but the flute is basically a very simple musical instrument, which, depending where you open and close the holes, you'll get a different frequency because you're actually getting the vibration according to the length of tube which you are using before the air comes out, okay? So if you open one of the holes, as you can see right at the bottom, you get a different note to when you close all the holes except a few at the top. Now, in other words, the frequency that you get in a tube depends how long the tube is that you are using, and you can vary that on a flute. For the human ear, of course, it's fixed. Let's go back to slide five. You'll see that the human ear is about 2 to 3 inches long. Now, get this. The natural frequency, just like the frequency of a flute, there is a natural frequency depending where you press the holes. For the ear, the natural frequency is the length of the ear canal. It was linked to the length of the ear canal. And that length is about 2 to 3 inches. What this is really saying is that the outer ear, we haven't got to the really complicated bit yet, but the outer ear naturally resonates like a flute at 4,000 cycles per second, which is human speech.
The human ear is a very, very clever piece of equipment, basically.
Let me just repeat the calculation so that people can do it off air at home, and they can find this out for themselves. You take the speed of sound, which is 300 meters per second, which is 300 times another 100 to get it to centimeters, right? So mm-hmm. it's 300 times 100 will get you into centimeters. Then you divide it by 4,000 cycles per second, so it's just 4,000 per second.
So and anybody could do this, yeah?
Yeah, anybody could do that. What I'm saying is you get the answer about 7.5 centimeters. That's about 3 inches.
Right.
So that's exactly
what the human ear is.
The human ear is the ear canal. So your ear canal is meant to pick up and resonates well with human speech. It's absolutely incredible. That's the first point I wanted to make. Now we need to move on, and now we come to slide six. If you just pull that up. Now you can see the whole of the ear is in the picture now. We've talked
That's
about
right.
the outer.
We've got a close-up of it now, yep.
Yep, now we've got the outer ear on the left. Then you can see in the middle you've got the eardrum, and you've got three little bones behind it, which I'm going to talk about it. On the right, you have what's called the inner ear, which I will come to. So let's now go to the middle ear. In the middle ear, you have this eardrum in picture number six, which is vibrating. Now, it will be vibrating as a result of my speaking or anybody speaking to you or whatever sound you've got of an aircraft, of music, anything making a noise. Your eardrum is vibrating. So we talked about this vibrating air doing that.
Yep.
Now the eardrum is vibrating in sympathy, and it will vibrate at whatever frequency is coming in. It isn't necessarily 4,000 cycles per second. All I'm saying when it comes to the 4,000 is that that is the natural frequency of the ear canal. But you can equally well hear things up to about 10,000 cycles per second, or you could hear the hum right down to electricity in the mains at about 60 yep. cycles per second. Okay, so yep. you've got a big range. Now, when that eardrum is vibrating, Howard, behind it, you've got three bones. Let's now consider those bones. We come on to the next slide, which is slide 7. You've got three little ossicle bones, we call them. Those ossicle bones, it's just a technical term, is for three tiny little bones, which, by the way, never change their size from when you were born as a baby. This is utterly amazing, because normally the bones in every creature keep on growing, but these bones don't grow. These bones are individual bones, but they're linked, as you can see in this diagram.
The bone, I've got the hammer.
Yep,
exactly. The anvil and the stirrup.
You are exactly right. So you've got the hammer, which is, the technical term is the malleus. Then you've got the anvil, because it looks a bit like an anvil. Its technical term is the incus. And the third bone is loosely called the stirrup, because it looks like the stirrup on a horse.
Yep.
You know, as though you were mounting a horse. But it's the technical term is a stapes. Now, these are linked, but they're not... they're not all linked such that you can't bend them. You can bend the linkages. So we'll go to see in a moment a little video which shows the hammer, first of all, moving. The hammer is connected on the left, but it's not shown on this figure, to the eardrum, which is vibrating, like the drum skin of a drum. The drum is vibrating already due to the sound waves. Now, the drum is physically connected to the malleus, right? So every time the eardrum moves, it pushes the malleus. The malleus then pushes the incus, or the anvil, and the anvil then pushes the stirrup. But amazingly, and this is quite extraordinary, the amount of movement is greater on the right than it is on the left. So whereas we've just got a very tiny movement of the hammer, the stirrup ends up moving a lot more. The amplitude is much greater. Now, why is this? Well, there is a reason for it, which I'm going to come to, and it's to do with the fact that we are moving from movement of air into movement of liquid. If we now come to picture number 8, I'm just going to refer to what the stirrup is moving into. The stirrup pushes against another remarkable part of the ear, which is the inner ear. We're going to look at this in a bit more detail in a few moments.
So this is the cochlea, is it?
This is the cochlea. Now, the cochlea is rather like a cockle shell, hence the name, because it's got a spiral. And that cochlea is full of liquid. And because it's full of liquid, it needs much greater movement in order to get a recognizable signal. Air compresses easily. Liquid does not compress, which is why you need a large movement from the stirrup. Now, I'm going to explain this in more detail. Now, we're going to come to slide number 10, 10A and 10B.
Yeah, the animations, yeah.
Yeah, now, if you pull up slide 10A and 10B, what you will see is the movement of these ossicle bones. When your viewers see these, this is utterly extraordinary, because it's an old movie, so you can see a very old electric bell sending out its signal. Then you've got the sound wave simulated on the left.
Yep, and you've got you can see the stirrup there working away in between what appear to be two inner bones.
Yeah, now the other two bones I've mentioned, you've got the hammer and the anvil, right? The hammer is pushing against the anvil, and the anvil actually amplifies the signal from the hammer. And the amount of energy used is almost the same. In other words, it's almost a perfect transmission device. And the amount of energy used is proportional to the area represented by the width of the movement here times the amount of amount moved in the amplitude of the signal. So you've got the hammer moving very small amount times a large area, and the stirrup is moving a large amount times a small area. So the amount of energy is roughly the same. This shows remarkable design. You can also see in this video that the linkages are flexible between the hammer and the anvil and the anvil and the stirrup.
Yep.
For anybody to argue that these three little bones, which, as I said, never grow, were produced by random mutations from a reptile ear. In fact, what they say, it was a reptile jaw which actually shifted its position. Small bones of the reptile jaw moved and became these three little bones, or one of the three little bones in a mammal. It is frankly absurd to even suggest it, but that is what evolutionists actually propose.
Yeah. So what you're seeing here is pretty much a proper designed receptacle for sound to be evaluated and interpreted by the human brain.
Yes, we haven't got to the brain bit yet, but we're getting there. It's astonishing even at this point, because anybody who is an engineer can see immediately the marks of brilliant craftsmanship.
It is amazing. And I'm really glad that you're dealing with this. I mean, I haven't watched this before. This is like the usual Revelation TV style. Just sit down, let's talk about it, let's get on with it and produce another program. But this is fascinating, Andy. Well done.
I'm so glad that you think so, Howard, because to me, I think I can see immediately, but then I am an engineer, but I'm sure there's other people out there who don't need to have lots of degrees in biology and even in engineering to see what is frankly obvious.
Yeah, it is amazing, you know, and the fact is that it had to work in its infancy as it is now, as old as it is, however old you think we are in the terms of being in existence. This is amazing, and this shows an intelligent design at the very least, and we of course attribute that to our Creator God.
Undoubtedly. You know my position, that I actually have been on the program before and argued for a young Earth and a global flood from the fossils. But we can all agree, whatever we think about age of Earth issues, as you rightly say, this is showing the mark of design. Now, if you look at the other video, which should have been running as well, which was the video 10B, this also shows now another remarkable fact, because this video is actually looking at what happens inside the inner ear as those bones are moving. So we're looking at the video on the right-hand side.
Yeah, I can see that. And what we've got really is an anti-clockwise movement in a circular fashion.
Yes, you have. But let me explain that a bit, if I may. So you've got the airwaves coming in on the hammer on the left. Then the three little bones, anvil and stirrup, are moving.
Yep.
And you can see that there is two openings of the inner ear. The top opening is actually an opening which is where the stirrup is connected, right? So the stirrup is connected to this top opening, right?
Yes.
Can you see that there?
We've got that.
Now, that top opening is where the ear, the inner ear, has to have the connection, obviously, with the stirrup. But now, if you notice that there is two openings, we call the top opening the oval window. There, if you like, there's a membrane which is separating the air on the left from the liquid on the right, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But if you notice, there is, if I had a pointer, I would point to it, but I just need to describe it to you. Below the stirrup, is another opening with another membrane, and we call this the round window, right? So there's an oval window. You can't see whether it's oval or not because we're looking to end on.
Yes.
Now, that one which is moving out when the stirrup moves in is absolutely essential. Let me explain why. This sounds technical, but follow me. Remember I said that liquid is not compressible, right? Okay. If I get a bicycle pump and instead of filling it with air, fill it with liquid, right? Mm-hmm. Put my finger over the end, push the handle down. I wouldn't be able to push the handle down because
there's no give in it.
Yeah. If I do that with air, as you well know, most of you, if you've got a bicycle pump, put your finger over the end, you can push the bicycle pump handle in. So liquid is not compressible. So in the inner ear, you've got liquid. Therefore, when you push against that liquid with the stirrup, you've got to have some give somewhere, otherwise you're going to break the inner ear. This is the mark of brilliant design, Howard, because that little lower window, we call it the circular window, is actually made of a membrane which gives every time the stirrup pushes in. I find that stunning. Without that, our ears wouldn't have worked. Every little bit of this is needed for the ear to work.
Okay, just a little bit of clarity on this, because I know we're doing a pretty much impossible task here. You can't see what we're seeing because we're putting that into the program now. I'm seeing is this circular movement in the inner part of this ear, the other side of the stirrup. But where is the escape of the, if you like, the pressure that's put on this liquid that's in that part of the ear, where is that going out? Because I can only see it recycling.
Right. I think this is probably the limit of what we can do on this program. But let me try and explain it nevertheless. What you've got here, as you look at that right-hand video, is a movement of something that looks like a bit of string. I'm coming to that. I haven't yet commented
on that. Okay, carry on then.
I'm only commenting at the moment on the stirrup on the left pushing in.
Yep.
And below it, there is another membrane which pushes out.
Yes.
It's out of phase. That's the point that I've been making. Every time the stirrup moves in,
it's going the opposite way.
Pushes out because the liquid is not moving at all out of the inner ear. It is moving, but it's not moving out of the inner ear.
Okay, right. So it's staying put.
It's staying put, but it's under pressure, and that pressure's got to go somewhere. That's
right.
The only thing.
That's good. Well, that helps me to understand.
Yeah. Now let's look at this, what looks like a bit of string, which is in an in a coil. Now, because of this movement of the stirrup, it's now causing a vibration in liquid. Now, that vibration is of what's called, this bit of string is actually called the basilar membrane. The liquid you can regard as something like water, but it's not actually water. It's actually a very special liquid.
Can I just ask you this? Is this what you would refer to if you say that, well, you've burst your eardrum? Is that where we talk about liquid coming out of that?
Or? Yes, it would be. If you burst the eardrum, it wouldn't necessarily burst what I've just referred to, which is the inner ear, because between the eardrum and the inner ear is these three
membrane.
Little bones.
Yeah.
But when you burst the eardrum, you can get the eardrum to gradually repair, but liquid is on the other side of the stirrup, not of the hammer.
Ah, right. Okay.
Okay. So there is this little gap where the little bones are.
Okay. Otherwise, it would be maintained in there, intact, all throughout one's life.
Yes, it would be. The liquid is there all the time.
Let's move on.
It's quite remarkable. Now, let's move on to slide number 11, where now we summarize what's going on in the inner ear. And this is where it gets extremely interesting. The cochlea is what we've just looked at. Inside that cochlea, what looked like a bit of string, the technical term for it is a basilar membrane. The basilar membrane is rather like an xylophone. All of you, as a child, will probably remember of playing with xylophones, where you hit a particular part of the xylophone and it makes a note, hit another point and it makes a different note.
They're all in different lengths.
They're all in different lengths, and that's why you get different notes. Now, that cochlea, if we unwind it, is rather like an xylophone. So if we come on to slide number 12, we've got here a little video clip. You will actually see the cochlea is unwound. And it's like an xylophone, and you get different notes. I'll just let you play it because I can hear it being played.
It's like a church organ.
Indeed. You literally have a little organ in your ear.
My goodness. So that's interpreting the different frequencies to give you a different tone.
Yes, but here comes the most remarkable bit, in my view, in terms of mechanical and sound engineering. We haven't yet got to the last bit, which is electrical engineering. But while we're on mechanical engineering, this is extraordinary. Because every time a note is played, the little basilar membrane immediately starts vibrating at the right frequency. So if I speak with a very high-pitched voice up here, a tiny little bit of the basilar membrane vibrates in accordance with that very high-pitched sound. If I speak with a very low voice like this, then immediately a different part of the basilar membrane is vibrating. So we have here an instantaneous frequency analyzer. Now, if you speak with sound engineers, they will all tell you that they need a tiny bit of signal, which is of finite time, before they can analyze that signal and work out what frequencies are being used. Now, what I'm saying is that it's effectively instantaneous for the basilar membrane to pick out all the various frequencies which are being used. I'm speaking to you with frequencies which are round about 4,000 cycles per second, but some of them will be as low as 3, some of them will be as high as 4,500. So are you, Howard.
Mm-hmm.
So all these frequencies are not pure tones. What I'm saying is that any sound that comes in, the basilar membrane immediately splits it into its component frequencies. Now, you ask your sound engineers in your studio whether they could do that, and they can't.
There's no way. Nobody can. Not that fast. That is amazing.
Now let me illustrate by playing video number 14.
Yes, we see it now. Yeah. It's almost looks like a frequency analyzer.
It is.
Oh. There you go.
It's a digital frequency analyzer. So what I've done there is mimic what the basilar membrane is doing. But in order to make life simple, I've put in pure tones. So I've got a frequency generator, which I picked up and played, first of all, one frequency, then another to produce a chord. Now, your ear is like that frequency analyzer, which I've just simulated on a video 14. Now imagine what it's like when you get music. What I'm really now going to say is that your ear, our human ear, is designed for listening to music. Now, I need to put a caveat before we play video 15. So before we play video 15, let me say this. Because I can hear my opponents saying, but we are just mammals. Other mammals also have ears, which are very sophisticated, like I've just been saying. And they will say, but they can listen to much higher frequencies than we can. That's true. A dog has a very similar set of ossicle bones, just like we do, and a cat equally so, and all mammals. But the huge difference is that we are all designed to listen to different frequencies. A cat can hear human speech, but it naturally wants to hear much higher frequencies. It can hear things right up to 60,000 cycles per second. A dog can hear way up to 40,000 cycles per second. Our hearing is designed for 4,000, and as a baby, we can hear sounds up to 20,000 cycles per second. But as you get older, even into your teens, you begin to lose those upper registers. So the difference is that although we are all mammals with all having this system, the natural frequencies that we are geared, as it were, to listen to reflect what each creature is designed to do. And we are designed for human speech. So, as I said earlier, our natural frequency is 4,000 cycles per second.
And music, which is amazing, because the thing is, when you think that in the ear is doing all of that and interpreting all those mixed frequencies from a whole orchestra, yeah, instantaneously, otherwise it will be just a big mess that we would be hearing.
It certainly would be, Howard.
It is so beautiful, music, and God created music as well for us to enjoy. It gave us the ability to amplify it and hear it and interpret it. It's just fantastic. This is amazing. Carry on.
Now I'm going to play, and perhaps this is the climax of what I'm saying to you on this program. Now let's play video 15, because this is the tune Dances of the Wolves. And you can see different frequencies as the lead frequency. And we can pick out these frequencies immediately. And your ear is immediately appreciating the music.
Yes, I can even actually tell you what note it's playing, whether it's F or, yeah, or B flat, or I mean F sharp.
Yeah, so what I've put on the video is the appropriate lead frequency that the violins are playing. But what you've also got is all the other frequencies of the accompanying orchestra. So what?
And the harmonies as well.
Yeah. So that is a plot of frequency, right, against the scale of a piano underneath.
Yes.
Right? So clearly, we are not just hearing one frequency, we're hearing a whole range of frequencies. And your basilar membrane is doing all that in your ear all the time.
It's just fantastic, absolutely. Well, hopefully people will start to understand just how amazing our God is, really. And yeah, it couldn't possibly have come through just evolution.
Yeah, that's right. Our God is a God of beauty, Howard. Our God is a God of music. Our God is a God of communication. Our God, in that sense, over-designs. If he just wanted to communicate basic speech, then he wouldn't put such a range in your ear that can appreciate things which are very low frequency and also extremely high frequency as well. In that sense, it's over-designed. This is what I have written on, and Stuart Burgess, my colleague, has written on, which is showing the evidence of beauty in nature, the beauty in the way human beings are made. Beauty, I agree, corrupted, because we're no longer what we were, because a lot of ugly things are now our experience, and people also, of course, don't always make beautiful sounds. They sometimes make very ugly sounds, which are not music. But we are basically originally made beautiful and are built to appreciate beauty, but that's got marred by sin.
Mm. Well, we've probably only got about 15 minutes left. I'm not quite sure. So
I'm almost through.
Right.
So now we just need to come to the last bit, because we've got a basilar membrane which is moving, but that basilar membrane is also connected to yet another organ, which is called the organ of Corti. If you pull up slide 19, this is not something which is obvious, and I can't easily put up a diagram here to fully explain it. But above the basilar membrane, as it's moving, it's actually causing little hairs on yet another membrane, which is very close to the basilar membrane, to move. And the hairs literally, physically move in one direction and are attached to each other by a mechanical spring. As the mechanical spring is extended, as you can see in this picture, slide 19, bottom picture on the right, you can see the hairs moving sideways. And as they move sideways, there is literally a mechanical spring which will eventually pull them back again to a vertical position. But as the hairs get separated, there is a potential difference caused between the adjacent hairs, which causes an electrical signal. This just blows the mind, because we've got to get a signal which is mechanical converted to a signal which is an electrical signal
to get to the brain.
Exactly, you've got it.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to go into detail on the organ of Corti, but suffice to say that close to the basilar membrane is the organ of Corti, which causes these hairs to vibrate, right? The basilar membrane, as it pushes, causes there to be a movement of this other membrane where the hairs are attached. Now I need to play you the last video, which is video number 20. Perhaps that could be pulled up, please. And you will find that this video shows to you, it's a silent video. It's not an old video. It's not one of the silent movies, although the earlier ones were close to the age of the silent movies. But this is a movie showing you the basilar membrane, then this other membrane, which is pushing against the hairs. And as they slide, they're causing a potential difference between adjacent hairs. That then sends an electrical signal to the brain. So that is how we hear, Howard.
It's amazing.
It is simply extraordinary. So it's a chemical transformation from mechanical energy. It goes to chemical energy, which then goes to electrical energy. It's quite extraordinary.
It is. But can I just something, when you first started talking about this, I was thinking about the miracles which Jesus performed when he was on the earth. And he, yeah, the deaf heard and the blind saw. We know that there are times when, you know, the Lord was questioned about why would this man in the condition he was. Was it something his parents did or sinned or whatever it was? If, for example, somebody who is deaf today, is it something that is a particular area, whether it's at this last point where it turns into electrical charge, doesn't happen, so that the man can't or the woman can't hear the sound? Where normally is the fault?
Well, it can be a number of faults. The eardrum can be impaired. If you have a perforated eardrum, you can't hear. Also, another reason is that the hairs in the, they're called cilia, right? If those hairs are damaged, then the person won't be able to hear because the cochlea isn't working properly. And people then have what's called a cochlear implant in order to take the vibration of the eardrum, or in fact, it bypasses the eardrum as well. The microphone immediately sends it as a signal translated to electricity to the ear. That's the cochlear implant.
Right.
So it could be in a number of locations in this system.
Okay, would that be the same for somebody who's born deaf, for example?
Born deaf, it really can be a number of issues. It can just simply be that the system is broken, as I've just described,
right. Okay.
Or else some of the bits are missing. Can I show you slide 23?
Yes, please do.
This is an important point, because the evolutionist, and sadly there are some Christians who believe in evolution, and by evolution I mean not adaptation, which I do accept. I mean this changing from one creature to another. And they believe that a reptile changes to a mammal. Now, it's mainly that area that I am saying that scientifically I completely disagree. They say that a reptile, like a crocodile or like some other reptile, has changed into a mammal. If they're going to say that, then they have to argue that the hearing system of a reptile, which is illustrated in the lower part of figure 23,
yep.
Which only has a stirrup or a stay piece and an eardrum, it does not have, and this is important,
the hammer.
It doesn't have the hammer, and it doesn't have the incus, which is the anvil, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, they argue that those two bones that are essential, very small but very essential in the mammal, have literally come, please look at the lower picture.
From the jawbone.
From the jawbone of a reptile, which is not made, the lower part of the jawbone is made of three bones, which is correct. And they say that the articular
bone, which is right on the end.
Exactly. And the quadrate from the upper jaw have mm-hmm. actually moved, literally, gradually moved over, they say, millions of years. I don't accept that. And moved into the inner ear, or the middle ear, I should say, of the mammal. Brian Cox even said this in one of his programs and even used a flick book in order to illustrate this. But the flick book showed that there was no real evidence because nobody's ever found clear evidence at all to show that this has happened. Frankly, the science of this is off the wall. It's not science at all. It's just imagination.
Very good. Now, so where do you want to go from here?
Well, can I just put up figure 27?
Yeah. Okay, how many figures do we have today?
Two more. Left.
Oh, good. I mean, you can have as many as you like, sir.
No, I've just about finished. And thank you to you, and thank you to all the team for putting this together. It's really been so good of you. In figure 27, or whatever this is, it says...
Am I refusing to hear God's voice?
Yeah, exactly. This
got the
is
right one.
Spiritual application. Now, obviously, I've been talking about the physical hearing, but... When people insist that God is not there, or else they say if God is there, he's incidental and evolution is what has built the mammalian ear and the human ear in particular, I maintain that they are ignoring Romans 1:20, which says the invisible things of God are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. And the verses before Romans 1:20 says, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress or hold the truth in unrighteousness. Then it says, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. In other words, God has not made a mistake when he wrote that verse. Remember I said at the beginning, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Our own ears, our own body, our own eyes, the way we are made shows to us that God has built us, that we are made in his image. And if we ignore this, we are refusing to hear God's voice, which of course is a spiritual hearing problem. And I'm asking that men and women who listen or view this program open their minds, open their ears spiritually to God's voice. Christ died on the cross that we might be forgiven. He died in order to redeem us. But in order for us to understand that message, we must first understand that God has fearfully and wonderfully made us, Howard. I know you wonderfully propagate these truths on Revelation TV, and I want your viewers to understand that although I want them to understand creation, I'm much more concerned that they listen to God's voice concerning redemption and what Jesus Christ has done for them on the cross.
Amen.
Could I just put up slide 28, which has some websites that people can refer to if they want to know more information on these issues?
Yes, they're up.
There is a number of creation ministries that can be looked at. Answers in Genesis, I'm associate with. You might like your viewers to go to that. Truth in Science, I'm a co-director of. And there is also Biblical Creation Ministries there. My own website is andymacintosh.org.
We've got a couple of minutes left, so that's quite, it's rounding up very nicely, Andy. You've done a brilliant job, really. I mean, and this is almost an impossible task. You're not seeing what we're seeing, and we're seeing something you're not seeing. But hopefully, in order to get, we don't have the BBC funding, but we're still doing an amazing job, really, to get the truth across to people that there is a wonderful God out there. He's not just a monster, or a lot of people are trying to make him out to be such a bad God. You know, it's like he's responsible for all the evil in the world, etc., which is rather sad when he's gone to great lengths. Andy, just one other question on this ear, the capabilities. How does it deal with an increase or a decrease in volume? How does the brain interpret that? Is it all done from the inner ear as well?
Any sound can be split into various frequencies and amplitudes, as we've just been saying. If you have too much of an amplitude, like hearing a jet engine head on, then that would be highly dangerous and would blow your eardrum to bits. So there is a limit as to what you can listen to. If you get a sound very, very loud indeed, it becomes painful, and you could actually, as I say, then damage the ear. But all that's quite a wide range, and God has made us primarily to listen to human speech. And may I say that we're designed to hear God's voice as well when it's read, when the scriptures are read. We should be particularly open to that in particular, and we should really listen to what God is saying to us. He may shout to us, and he may sometimes, spiritually, I'm drawing a lesson from this, he may sometimes have to make it painful for us to hear. But in terms of physical hearing, our ears can hear a huge range. Let's use our ears wisely.
Yeah. Thank God also he speaks in a small, still voice as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's very true.
And Andy Macintosh, Professor Andy Macintosh, you've been absolutely amazing today. And it's been a real pleasure to have a real good look at part of the human body, which we probably take for granted, our hearing, and how we can do this. And then also give it as a testimony to others who question our faith, that we can give a simple explanation now and use some of these diagrams. So I say to our viewers, you know, thank you. Do get in touch with Andy directly through his website and also the others if you want to find out more about how amazing the body is.
And Howard, let us always remember that creation, it shouldn't be just left there. We must go to the cross and what Christ did on the cross for us primarily.
Amen. Yes, we do have a Saviour in Jesus.
Amen.
So thank you to all of you and to the team for watching Revelation TV and the special one with Professor Andy Macintosh. Thank you. Bye-bye.